Hello and welcome to another episode of Champaign Connection. I'm Rick Atterbury, your host. The Ebola outbreak in West Africa has been a hot topic on the national news. But how real is the threat here in central Illinois? We'll show you how Champaign County is well prepared for any disease outbreak and why local authorities say the public shouldn't worry. Plus, when blizzard conditions blanket central Illinois, most of us will probably huddle inside by the fire and wait for the snowplows to dig out the city streets. But what goes into keeping Champaign streets safe and passable? We'll review the city's snow and ice control plan and discuss how some new changes will speed up and improve services. And Champaign residents can help the snowplow drivers get that job done faster and safer. We'll share some tips on what you can do to help and why it's important to keep certain sidewalks free of ice and snow. It's another great episode you won't want to miss. This episode of Champaign Connection starts now. Our guest is Julie Pryde, the administrator at the Champaign-Urbana Public Health District. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, I am originally from the Decatur area, and I moved here to go to college, and like so many others, I stayed. I've been with Champaign-Urbana Public Health District for about 20 years now, and I have been the administrator for about seven.
We're here to talk about infectious diseases, and we've gone through MERS, Ebola, SARS, H1N1. Always seems to be something looming. Have the outbreaks become more frequent, or do we just know more about them?
Well, I think that we know more about them, but there definitely are some different diseases out there, some kind of emerging infectious diseases. MERS is new, SARS is new, H1N1 is a different strain of flu. So there are a lot of emerging diseases out there, but I do think that in our community we are far more likely to be aware of them and talk about them than a lot of places.
Is this community more at risk because of the presence of the university and a whole lot of other people who travel a lot?
Well, any infectious disease is always a plane ride away. So, you know, the world is really a much smaller place than it used to be because people do travel everywhere. I think that we are honestly a little less at risk because we are more aware of it and we pay more attention to it than most places do.
What are some of the steps that you and other responders in the community have taken to prepare for these kind of outbreaks?
Well, you know, we practice together. All of the people in the community, all of the different pieces play together. We work together. We all know each other, which is very helpful. I did notice that one of the things that Texas talked about is that during this Ebola situation, they said that, well, now at least we're talking. Mm. Well, you really need to talk and communicate and know each other long before that happens. A lot of what public health does is educational information, getting out the information, the real information. The part of the fun with the internet is anyone can Google anything and probably scare themselves half to death. So we try to get accurate information out in a timely manner and let everyone know the steps. So we're very transparent about what is involved. Like with H1N1, here's when the vaccine will be here, who is eligible for it, when will you be able to get yours. Please get your flu shot ahead of time. We always push that. I'm always, always urging people to get their flu shots because a lot of infectious diseases present the same way a flu would.
I remember with H1N1, that the community went so far as to, in a lot of locations, put little signs on the employee entrances that says, if you're not feeling well, turn around and go home.
Exactly. And, you know, that's a basic public health, one of our basic public health steps that we always urge people to do. If you are sick, stay home. If your child is sick, do not send your child to school. And certainly, you know, if you do that, you're not going to spread it. And so that's like step number one. You know, a lot of what public health does, some people might consider common sense, but it really isn't because people don't do it. So wash your hands frequently. Don't touch your face. That's not when you're taught, but that's really a good way to prevent getting a lot of viruses in your body. Things like that. Don't go to work if you're sick. And no one wants to pass something on. So get your flu shot. Anything that is preventable, prevent it.
You mentioned people getting information from the internet, which may or may not be accurate. When it comes to, I think, one of the myths about Ebola versus flu is the method of transmission, and people think, if my neighbor sneezes on me, I'm going to get sick. Well, you may get sick, but you're not going to get Ebola.
Correct. And I think that every time there's a new disease out there, people are going to pretty much address it as they do whatever they're the most familiar with. Mm-hmm. So everybody knows how you get flu or cold. And so we fight against that all the time, whether it's something like hepatitis A, which is a foodborne illness, or if it is Ebola, which requires, you know, contact, or if it's tuberculosis, which requires kind of sustained contact. It's every disease is a little different, and you need to know what the how you can actually get it in order to know how to protect yourself.
Is the flu vaccine this year a good representative formulation? Some years they nail it, some years they don't.
Well, so far we believe it is, but you know, anything can happen. And that's the thing about, that's why everyone has to get a flu shot every year, is because the flu viruses, they mutate so rapidly that every year it can be a little bit different. Now, some years you have, you know, two or three kinds of flus that are possible to go around. And each flu vaccine is what we call a trivalent, meaning that it has three strains in it. And now this year and last year, we've had access to quadrivalent, meaning four strains. And how they pick that is they look at what's going around in the southern hemisphere. They pick what's mostly going around there, and then that's what we vaccinate ourselves against. Because again, influenza every year is, it's going to be there every single year. You're not going to catch Ebola, but you will catch flu if you do not get a flu shot and take care of yourself.
What are some of the other steps beyond getting the flu shot that people should be observing, not just this time of year, but good hygiene all year round?
Yeah, it's really, you know, hand washing, and that is like so key to everything. And if you go and sit in a restaurant and just watch people, you know, it, you can look, you can give them a piece of irradiated food that is completely pathogen free. They pick it up with their hands and eat it, and they haven't washed their hands. Whatever is on their hands is going into their body. And so, you know, we're our own worst enemy, essentially, if we don't wash our hands. Of course, they're going to want to blame the restaurant, mm-hmm. but you know, it's typically hand washing. Go into a restaurant, watch, see how many people walk to the bathroom and wash their hands before they sit down.
People are rightly concerned about things like Ebola because mm-hmm. it's kind of an unknown. Mm-hmm. It is devastating when it happens. But earlier this fall, the enterovirus, the mm-hmm. D68, was starting to affect children in particular, in large numbers, and there were some fatalities. And mm-hmm. that concerns me more than Ebola, as a grandfather.
Right, and I can tell you, if we hadn't have got Ebola in the U.S., that would have been number one in the media, and that would have been number one on everyone's mind, because that is concerning. There's anything that we don't have a vaccine against that is spread that way is always going to be concerning. Of course, with the enteroviruses, there are, you know, every year, basically when you say someone has a cold, you're talking about several kinds of different viruses that they could have. We just don't usually talk about it unless there's something specific, a specific outbreak. But unfortunately, sometimes public health is on people's minds based on what is in the media, not what is the reality of what is concerning. Because, you know, a good example, again, flu, 30 to 40,000 Americans will die from flu every single year, despite the fact that we have vaccination. And, you know,
it's just people need to take responsibility themselves.
Right. Now, they do need to be concerned about Ebola in the sense mm-hmm. that unless we get it taken care of in Western Africa, there will always be that risk here. And, you know, it's been around since 76, but nothing like an outbreak like this, nothing like it. And so we need to be concerned that we make sure that it gets controlled over there. Or any place it pops up, it can affect us because it's a plane right away.
Thanks for being with us today.
Thank you.
The public health district and local medical facilities are well prepared to manage any possible disease outbreaks in Champaign-Urbana. For more information, visit c-uphd.org.
The City of Champaign's CGTV, Cable Channel 5, connects you to your community. CGTV broadcasts local governmental meetings, informational and educational programming, and important announcements concerning public safety, road closures, and community events. CGTV is your source for valuable information about what's happening in Champaign. The City of Champaign's CGTV, keeping you connected.
Our guest is Ernesto Salinas. He's the operations manager in Public Works, and we're going to talk about snow removal. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me here today.
The city council's made recently some changes in the way that the snow plan is initiated. Can you tell us about those?
I think the majority of the changes are essentially speeding up our process or our response times for the clearing of snow. But for the most part, these changes are actually reflecting what we currently do, what our current operational practices are. So for instance, in the past, we may have been required to clear a cul-de-sac in 36 hours. Now it's been sped up to 24 hours. But again, that matches up what we were doing already.
And I understand at some point, the snow routes are going to go away, but not right away.
I think you're referring to the emergency snow
routes. The emergency snow routes.
Right,
yes.
That's something that we are evaluating this year for consideration of removal next year. But again, I want to emphasize that is for the emergency snow routes.
So the people who live on those main streets that are already marked, they know the routes.
But right, they know their particular routes. And again, this primarily deals with parked cars on streets such as University, Church, State. And again, we're looking at the value of declaring an emergency snow route if that really helps us out or not. So we'll be looking at that and considering whether that change will be made.
But for this year, everything stays the same?
As far as that's concerned, yes, that does stay the same.
What's the general philosophy about what streets get cleaned in what order?
Okay, well, we have primary streets, or actually primary routes, and we also have secondary routes. And your primary routes are basically your arterial streets, the main streets that are trafficked or that are highly trafficked. And we'll clear those first, and then we move on to those secondary streets.
What are, to help people understand, can you name some primaries and some secondaries?
Sure, your primary streets, again, those are your main streets that people use to go about town. So you would look at a street like Neal, Kirby, Windsor, parts of Prospect and Mattis that are not owned by IDOT.
And then a secondary street would be?
Oh, Hill, Washington okay. Street, mm-hmm. Draper, more of your neighborhood type streets.
What are some of the special challenges? You mentioned cul-de-sacs, and it seems as new subdivisions are developed, they either have cul-de-sacs or curved streets. Nobody builds straight streets anymore.
Right, right.
What kind of special challenges does that happen?
I think with the cul-de-sacs, and there are various types of cul-de-sacs, mm-hmm. you might have a full circle cul-de-sac, or you might have some that are just maybe more of a half circle, and it complicates things sometimes. But the main challenge with the cul-de-sacs is it's fairly tight to get in there with our bigger snowplow trucks. So what we tend to do with that is to use our smaller trucks or perhaps use front-end loaders with blades on them to essentially, you know, negotiate those cul-de-sacs.
So each one's a little bit individual when it
right.
comes to defining what equipment
you Correct. And again, there are some areas, I mentioned those oddly shaped cul-de-sacs, and you'll have some that have more of a half shape, and depending on the type of storm that you get, it might actually cover it up, and if we're not careful, you might actually miss that particular half cul-de-sac. But the good news is that we have delineators, and I think people have seen those throughout town. They look like plastic brown sticks, mm-hmm. plastic sticks that help us to know where the cul-de-sacs or where obstacles might be in place.
When it comes to prioritizing things, too, healthcare institutions and fire stations and schools take a little bit of precedence?
Yes, they do. In fact, if you remember last year's blizzard, one of the things that we did was we tried to make sure that those were the primary areas that we went to. Now, most of these will be on the primary routes to begin with, but again, that is the emphasis. You go to those places first and you start from there in many instances. But again, referring back to last year's big blizzard in January, one of the things that we did is we tried to make sure that the warming centers had access for example, for many of the homeless that had to, you know, get access to those mm-hmm. places. So we made a concerted effort to make sure that those places were cleared first.
So you have a list of places that really common sense would dictate
yes.
that's a priority.
And again, your schools, your fire departments, your, you know, your police stations, your hospitals, bus stops, things of that nature.
Has increased development out on the fringes of town where there aren't any natural windbreaks is that a problem for you?
It's become a challenge for us as more and more development gets created in that area, it's become a bit of a challenge for us. So what we do is we essentially dedicate resources to those particular areas. And one of the interesting challenges is that even though a snowstorm, you know, may have passed through, it doesn't mean that snow drifting won't continue. A lot of times you'll have post-snowstorm winds, and in fact, a lot of the times the winds will actually kick up, and it makes no difference. It basically will create, you know, snow drift on those roads. So we tend to dedicate some resources to just keep monitoring and actually going through those roads even after the storm has long passed.
Out in the country, we used to call those ground blizzards. You could look up and see the sun, but you couldn't see in front of you.
And it's places like Staley Road, Rising Road, North Market that tend to have that. And part of it is the way the wind comes in will have might create problems.
Mm-hmm. When do you plow and when do you treat?
Okay, that's a bit more of a complex question with probably various factors that would fall into that. So there's not an easy response to it, but I can give you an example of some of those factors.
Sure.
And you might have a light storm that may not require much, but I mean, the reality is that you get different types of storms. So we have to consider such things as the type of storm that you're getting, pavement temperatures, temperature trends. Will the temperature drop and stay at a lower, temperature? Things of that nature need to be considered. But if we wanted to take, for instance, just a moderate to heavy snowstorm as an example, that would be the type of storm where we would treat, plow, most likely retreat, and replow again to make sure that accumulation is removed and snowpack doesn't develop.
You make an interesting point. No two snowstorms or ice storms are alike.
It's very rare for them to be alike. And if anything, last winter season proved that point. You had storms where, wind direction was a factor. It either came from the north, or in one instance, it kind of came from the east, and it plays a huge role. You might have dry snow, you might have wet snow. Again, just so many different factors. And in many instances, again, last year was a good example where the temperature just stayed so low for such a extended period that it made it quite a bit of a challenge.
That was a challenge for your people. It was a challenge for your equipment. That was just a tough winter.
It was, but I'm glad we were able to meet the challenge.
Speaking of last winter, has the city been able to fully restock salt and other supplies as we go into this one?
Yes, thanks to the fantastic support of the city manager and the city council, we are, happy to say that we are fully restocked at this point. We have 6,100 tons of bulk rock salt. We've got about 5,000 gallons of calcium chloride, and we've got additional deliveries that are staggered throughout the winter season.
What's the one thing you'd like to tell people about your operation, have them know about your operation?
I think that, we've got very many professionals working this. They've been doing this for quite a bit, and it's quite a bit of a sacrifice that they do and their families do when they do this. But everyone can rest assured that if there's going to be a snowstorm, we are ready and we will take care of it.
Well, good luck to you and everybody this winter. We'll hope that it's not the way it was last year.
Great.
Thanks for being with us.
Thanks for having me.
The Public Works Department takes great pride in keeping the city streets open, even in the harshest winter weather. For more information, check out the city's website at ci.champaign.il.us/snow. Our guests are Kris Koester, Administrative Services Supervisor and Public Information Officer in Public Works, and David Oliver, the Code Compliance Manager in Neighborhood Services. Welcome back to the show.
Thanks, Rick.
Kris, we'll start with you. As we move into the snow season, what's the number one thing that the rest of us can do to help out the Public Works people?
I think the Public Works goal is to always have streets plowed, as wide of berth as possible, so as much from curb to curb. So if residents can use off-street parking so that we can plow and not have snow build up on the sides, we think that's the ideal situation. However, we understand that not everyone has off-street parking available to them. And so, park as close to the curb as you can while still being able to maneuver your car. In the event that someone lives near downtown, we do offer the Hill Street parking deck as an option for off-street parking, you know, and that's available and also is free on the weekend. So, you know, if there's a snow event on the weekend, you can get free parking for your car. So,
indoors, keep the
indoors,
snow off.
Indoors, yeah.
It is a challenge in the older neighborhoods with homes that have been converted to apartments and some apartments with insufficient parking. But I think if people park on the street, it's just kind of a given. They have to be prepared to dig out. You can't help it.
Right.
I've seen people shovel or plow snow out of their driveways or off their sidewalks and dump it in the street so you guys could take care of it. Yeah. How does that mess up your process?
Well, it does create sort of a double work situation. If we've already been down a street, then someone calls and says, you know, there's this pile of snow that we have to then dispatch resources back to take care of. Shoveling your snow off your private property into the street is actually a violation of city ordinance, so we discourage people from doing that. And some tips that we have are, if you're plowing your driveway or your sidewalk, to put the snow in the pile on your own property to the left of the driveway, or in other words, the side of the driveway that's the furthest from oncoming traffic. That way, as plows come down, they're not replowing the snow that you plowed back onto your property.
I'm kind of, I'm lucky enough to have a snowblower, so I'll actually go out and do the street in the parking lane upstream from where the plows are likely to come, just to keep my driveway clear during the process.
Yeah, a lot of people do that,
And not everybody's lucky enough to have a snowblower, I know that, but I'm kind of a stickler about getting rid of the snow. When the plows are out and about, what's a safe distance for the driver to stay behind?
I think an important thing to help people remember is sort of, you know, if you look at the back of a lot of semis, they say, you know, if you can't see my mirrors, I can't see you. So that's a good general rule of thumb. We encourage as much distance as possible. There's a few things going on. You can't see what's in front of the plow, so there may be a hazard that they have to quickly maneuver around. There may be something in the ground where they have to lift up their blade to avoid, you know, breaking the blade. And also at the same time, on the rear of the plow, they're usually spreading salt or some other material. So generally 150 to 200 feet is good. You know, if you can go around them or give them as much room as possible, it's just a better driving experience for everyone. It also gives a chance for the salt to get down on the ground and provide additional traction for your vehicle.
David, let's talk a little bit about the rules that the city has for snow and ice removal from sidewalks, both downtown and in campus town. Can you summarize those?
Well, once the plowing is nearing completion, the Public Works Director will declare that our ordinance is in effect. When that declaration is made, the property owner has 48 hours to get the sidewalk clear in front of their business or their residence in those two areas, downtown and campus town. We always encourage residents or property owners not to wait for the declaration. Start clearing the sidewalk earlier because it's a lot easier, especially in campus town, because once the students start walking on it, it gets packed down and it's like a sheet of ice at that point, and it's hard to remove.
Why is it so important for the property owner to get that snow and ice off the walks?
Well, downtown and in the campus town areas, both are highly used by pedestrians. We have people that are handicaps that need wheelchair access as well. So it just makes the sidewalks more traversable for everyone.
If you've ever been in campus town or downtown and seen someone who's using a wheelchair try to navigate the corners when the property owner has piled the snow up there, it's just almost impossible for them.
Right, and the property owners that are on a corner are also responsible for the crosswalk as well. A lot of times a plow, when it goes through, it's going to leave a deposit of snow there, but they should clear that crosswalk as well.
It's just the right thing to do, too, really.
It is, and they can use pre-treatment on the sidewalk in advance of a snowfall. I mean, we all watch the weather. We know it's coming, but putting down a layer of salt will help get the snow and ice up off the sidewalk as well.
Are there rules for the rest of us out in residential neighborhoods about what we're required to do with our sidewalks?
No, not in the rest of the city. We don't have an ordinance that requires it, but being a good neighbor, it is a good idea to keep the sidewalk clear, especially when you know there's a high pedestrian area. If kids are working their way to schools, or if you're in a commerce area where people are walking to convenience stores.
Some people I've heard say, well, if I don't shovel, if I don't do anything, that's Mother Nature's job, that she put the snow there. I can't be sued if I don't touch it at all. But really, cases of people being sued for something they did to their walk are very rare.
It is rare, and I did consult with our city legal department. Property owners have tort immunity. They're not going to be sued if somebody slips, you know, because they've shoveled their sidewalk and then somebody slips and falls there. They shouldn't fear that at all. We should all take care of our sidewalks and just try to keep them clear.
Kris, in the process of people trying to help you guys out in snow removal, if they feel that, well, the it's 3 or 4 days in and they see something that they believe to be a hazard, how do they get in touch with you?
Sure. The Public Works Department is available at the phone number 217-403-4700. We're generally staffed 7:30 to 4:30, Monday through Friday. However, during snow events, we actually have people working there around the clock. We also have an after-hours answering service that takes calls. And they can email us at publicworks@ci.champaign.il.us. And we also have the new app, C-Click Fix. So, you know, feel free to download that. Allows you to take a picture, submit it, gives you tracking results of it. So we're very reachable. We even, you know, communicate a lot through the city's Facebook and Twitter. And so we want to provide as much information to our residents and visitors as we possibly can, and we also appreciate that information coming back to us.
It's a great point about befriending the city on Facebook for up-to-date information. And if folks have never used C-Click Fix, it's actually a real interesting tool that that people can use.
Yeah, it is a great tool.
Thanks to both of you for being with us here today.
Thank you. Thanks, Rick.
The city's goal is to provide the best service possible to residents during and after winter storms. You can help by following the tips provided by today's guests. For more information, check out the city's website at ci.champaign.il.us/snow. Thanks for watching this episode of Champaign Connection. Remember to tune in next time for another look inside the city of Champaign. On behalf of everyone here at the show, thanks for letting us keep you connected.